Studio performances from our very special guests. We broadcast live from the LA Talk Radio studios the first and third Saturdays of each month in stunning HD video. Thank you for tuning in to Inside the Music.
Good morning, everyone.
Morning.
Good morning.
Thanks, everybody, for tuning in to this episode of Inside the Music with Will and Jack. Will being Jay Gore today.
Yes, that's me.
Guitarist extraordinaire. And we have Keith McKelley, saxophonist.
Doing?
And we have Roberto Vally, bassist. Today's show is, the theme is kind of like, these guys are coming up to the front, because everybody here has been a sideman primarily.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So this is all about coming up to the front, and we're featuring you guys and your music, because with a lot of people don't know is the people behind the music that make it sound so good are you guys. And you guys also are recording artists and are creative and have great projects out there. So that's part of what we're going to be talking about today. And Jay Gore has a project too. What's the status of your project, Jay?
It's finished.
There you go.
I haven't released it yet, but it's done.
Yeah.
Got the cover art done. Everything's mastered and ready to go.
Whose photo did you use for the cover? Your picture, or you were going to use, who were you going to use?
The one I ended up using is one that was shot by Joanne Lang.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. And that's, it's a great shot.
And Jay is kind of setting new boundaries. Or
boundaryless, man.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Jay's doing a kind of like, it was called Guitronica.
Guitronica.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, a guitar thing.
Yeah, it's going to be cool.
Getting back to the photo, I'm hoping it's like a semi-nude kind of thing.
It is. Good. But you don't. There's lots of shadows strategically placed.
You're a classy guy.
I know.
I can't wait not to see it.
Is it classy when you have to tell people how classy you are?
I'll ponder that one.
Exactly.
So today we're going to start out with Roberto. Good morning, Roberto.
Good morning, Jack. Thank you so much for having me here.
Well, you know, Roberto was here approximately a year ago. And a year ago, we were introducing his CD, Pure Lines,
mm-hmm.
which is one of my favorite CDs, period.
Oh,
I mean, it's a genuine work of art. Every tune is really, really good.
Thank
love
you.
It, love it, love it. So,
getting goosebumps.
Yeah,
thank you.
Yeah, great job. Really, really good. So, Roberto, for our audience, the people that didn't tune in the last time, why don't you tell us, how did Roberto get to be a professional musician starting back from when you're
a
very
kid?
Young?
Oh, yeah. My gosh. Well, I had the good fortune of living in Brooklyn, New York, and they had a lot of music in the public school system. And thanks to my orchestra teacher, Walter Rosen, he recognized my ear and put me in the orchestra. And started playing bass at the tender age of 9 years old.
So how did you wind up picking up the bass of all instruments?
I kind of gravitated towards the low notes, and I just loved, I was a kind of tall guy, and I liked the size, I liked the sound, and I had a little bit of guitar at the house and a little bit of piano, private piano lessons, and once I had the bass in my hand, it was over.
Was your family musical, Roberto?
My mother, she sang. She liked to sing big band. She actually made a 78 with a music minus one back in the day.
Oh, wow.
My dad never had a chance to pursue his love of music as a player because he was too busy trying to make money in Italy. But he gave me the opportunity being first generation here in New York City. So,
So when you took the bass, like, in school, did you feel like you stood out or was natural for you? Could you see yourself someday being a professional musician?
You know, I felt like the bass was an old friend. Even at 9 years old, I didn't understand why it felt so familiar to me. even though I just started touching it for the first time, and it just felt like it was like a reunification with something that I was very, very familiar with.
So when did you progress to gigging? Have that happen?
Well, it wasn't soon after that. I was 12, 13 with a little rock pop band at home, and the drummer's dad was a casual office leader, and so he would give us all this work. So
you should explain to people what casuals are.
Okay, well, casuals in New York were considered club dates. A casual is anything from like a corporate party to a bar mitzvah to a sweet 16 party.
Right.
Block parties were big in New York at the time. So my parents, they had to get a station wagon and help us move the material, a little PA we had. And so I was gigging when I was 13, 14.
I have a question.
Yeah, man.
Why are gigs that we have to wear tuxedos to perform in called casuals?
That's a very good question.
Right.
See, that's why they call it inside the music, and that's why we have Jay Gore.
That's right.
Because who would think of that question?
No, because I did casuals for many years.
Yeah.
Put that tuxedo on every weekend.
Yeah.
To go play at the Horowitz Bar Mitzvah.
Right.
And
right.
I was wondering, why are we calling this a casual when it's anything but casual? Is it? It's just to be ironic.
Maybe it's just to poke fun even more at the monkey suit. Yeah, I got one in my closet.
Yeah,
you know,
well, we all do.
Gotta whip it out.
I got lots of things in my closet.
Whoa.
So you were in band in high school, I assume.
I was in it was all like classical and jazz in school, and then at home it was learning the pop songs of the day from Earth, Wind & Fire to Chicago, Kool & the Gang, et cetera.
Is that what you gravitated to?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. And also the early fusion stuff hit me hard at a nice ripe old age of 12, 13. I was deep into Headhunters, deep into Return of Forever, and I really was intrigued by a lot of notes back then. And I kind of grew out of that as I, progressed or regressed. I got more attracted to the simpler, kind of things that hit me harder. I didn't need all those notes.
Isn't that a true artist at that point if you can actually do what you need to do with less notes?
I don't know.
Well, he's a guitar player. You shouldn't ask him.
Thank you.
So Jay's a no on that one.
No, he's a big artist.
Yeah.
Beautiful artist. Yeah, man.
Okay, so after that, how did you wind up going to Juilliard?
Well, I had a private teacher who was a professor at Juilliard, so he got me enrolled in the preparatory division. So I would meet there on Saturdays, and I would go there once a week after high school. But I never did formal college there. I was enrolled in the Juilliard preparatory division. But I did go to the High School of Music and Art in Manhattan with the likes of Omar Hakim and Marcus Miller. And
that's the Fame School, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Wow. When did they film there? Shortly
they
after
filmed
there?
The year after I graduated. Yeah. Actually went there with a date who was, we shared the same birthday, but she was 3 years older than me, and I didn't want to, Mona Levy was her name, and I didn't want to let her know how young I was, but when I was watching the movie with her, I recognized so many people in the movie that they used in my senior class.
There
were extras that were just like all around there, so I just, yeah, so.
And then how did you become a professional musician?
Yeah.
What was the first breakthrough for you as far as being a professional musician?
Okay. After high school, I was lucky to join kind of a Tony Orlando and Dawn kind of a club band that were with people 10, 15 years my senior. And we toured around,
Did you audition for that, or how did
I
you
did.
Get it?
Yeah. I was the only guy who showed up, so I got the gig. I got the gig. I was 18. I was 18 years old. Well, anyway, I progressed from band to band. I did 3 years with a great jazz rock funk band out of Alabama, and I did time in Europe playing with one of my good friends, Mark McMillan, who we both played with Bobby Caldwell together. And through meeting people, I got a chance to audition for the Spyro Gyra guys, and I wound up getting the gig. So that was my first name gig, and that was 30 years ago. Gosh.
And Spyro Gyra, what was the, do you remember the first gig you played from? Were you nervous at all? I mean, they had a reputation, right?
Yeah, I was pretty nervous, but we did a lot of rehearsing, and we actually, I'm thinking, no, we did a few gigs, and then we went right into the studio. So it was kind of cool to play the songs live and then record them.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and they...
Did that influence how the songs developed, the fact that they played them live first?
Well, they were Jay and Tom, the guys with the most tenure, they were excited that they weren't doing the pancake layering effect. We went in and pretty much cut everything live, including percussion, and I guess it came out in the music.
Was that your first studio work like that?
On that level, I was in the studio lots before.
But. And what was that like? Was that exciting to be with guys on that level?
Yeah, it was very exciting, you know, playing with the cats, knowing that the bass player before me, they used the likes of Will Lee and Kim Stone, who was the bassist in the band before, but they had the budget and they had great music, and they had guys like Steve Gadd and Will Lee, you know, coming in and doing lots of their hits.
So, Roberto, you have something exciting going on right now. Do you want to tell us about that?
Sure.
Your latest project?
Yeah, well, about 10 months ago, Mark Nordman, who is the founder, CEO of Woodward Avenue Records, he approached me, and he would bounce a lot of stuff off my ears, some ideas. He'd call me up because I got to know him with his contact and friendship with Paul Brown and some other artists on his label. He'd call me or text me every once in a while, and, hey, I want to kind of do a version of Put It Where You Want It. What do you think? I'm like, great. So he's talking about some bass thing, a bass-heavy song, and maybe The Chicken or Birdland, whatever. And I said, hey, that's great. So he called me, and I said, so who's the artist you're thinking about? He said, I'm talking to him, Roberto. I want to give you a record deal to make a maxi single. So I ran with it, and
what's a maxi single? Okay. I don't know.
A maxi single is one song.
Okay.
With three to four different arrangements or mixes of
okay.
it. So
okay.
we have one that's like the saxophone radio edit.
Yeah.
We have a long one because we chose the song Birdland, which was a pretty tall order. So,
why don't you give our audience a little background to Birdland?
Okay. Well, I heard Birdland, I guess it was my junior year in high school. It just came out, and, you know, Jaco Pastorius busted on the scene with Weather Report. And Birdland was written by Joe Zawinul, one of the founders of Weather Report. And it was a pretty big hit for them, considering they were a fusion band. Birdland was a club in New York in the 50s, and it was named after Charlie Parker, whose nickname was Bird. So that's about as far back as I can go with that. But Manhattan Transfer in the 80s did a pretty cool version of Birdland, and they had great success with that. And I don't think a smooth jazz artist wanted to tackle that. So I considered it something I want to really pay good attention to. How could I introduce the song to a new generation and make it even hipper than the original, or as hip but just kind of different? So
why you what'd you do to make it to spin it your way, and who's playing on it?
Well, soon after I knew I was going to do it, I thought, who can I call to help me? Maybe I need a guy who plays serious keyboards, and I called my buddy from Spyro Gyra, Tom Schumann. And all I said to him was, Tom, would you want to maybe play some keyboards on Birdland? So he sent me an email the next day. He tracked the whole song and played all the instruments and basically just played the snot out of everything, the drums and everything. So I kind of used that as the working template. And I went to visit him in Las Vegas, and we spent some days together, and I overdubbed my bass, took his bass away. Overdubbed my bass and changed some arrangements. I asked them to do some different keyboard things. And then I took it home and I thought, how can I make this really more personal? So I started with trying different loops on it and seeing where that went, which made me kind of want to just erase all the drums that we had and just start from scratch. So I got my buddy Gordon Campbell to play some drums. So we took it like more swamp funk Louisiana, and gave it like a halftime kind of, you know, red beans and rice kind of deal. And as it kind of progressed, I thought, well, wouldn't it be nice to have some wah-wah guitar, and maybe I want to have some gospel churchy organ thing going on.
So this thing really evolved.
And the horn section, thanks to Greg Vail, put some nice, gave me some nice options, and we kind of listened to it and decided to go with the all saxophone choir. More power to the saxes, man.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Well, here we go. We're going to take a listen to Birdland.
Okay.
Did Paul have anything to do with this?
Paul mixed it.
I was going to say, it sounds, it has that glue that he has.
Yeah, definitely.
Everything he records sounds just so great.
Mm-hmm.
It's warm, and that you hear every detail of every instrument. His mixes are exquisite.
Yeah. I remember sitting there in front of his Neve, and he put it on, and I was nervous because I did the whole thing without him.
Right.
So I was wondering how he's going to approach it, and when I heard it and everything, and it definitely, he definitely glued it all together,
right?
You know,
Paul being the two-time Grammy Award winner, Paul Brown.
Mm-hmm.
For who I have to send a shout out of thank yous, because he really pushed me for years, like, Roberto, when are you going to make your own record? You've written dozens of songs for so many smooth jazz artists. when are you going to do something? I'll help you any way I can, Roberto.
And shout out to Mark Nordman too.
What Roberto is doing is he's making the bass solo not the part of the show where you go get beer anymore. it's you actually sit and watch the bass solo now.
And then I have a question for you as far as that goes. Well, first of all, Birdland, how's that tune doing for you?
It's doing quite well. I'm very happy that a lot of DJs are getting behind it. And thanks to the Woodward Avenue team, it's actually tied for second most added spins, and it just broke top 50 in Billboard Smooth
Awesome.
Jazz.
Congratulations.
And it's only been out less than 2 weeks.
Okay, let's talk about Pure Lines, because that's your album that came out probably, about a year ago now, right?
Yeah,
about a year ago. Beautiful artistry. If anybody wants to hear a great album, artistic, just a great listen, Pure Lines.
Thank you.
That I assume it's available at Amazon, iTunes, and all that.
All those places, CD Baby and RobertoValley.com.
Okay, and that's your second album. Your first was Boom, Boom, Boom.
Boom, Boom, Boom. Yeah.
Okay, so tell me, how did Pure Lines come about?
Well, I wanted to just keep the ball rolling. I just love giving the listener a very musical self-portrait of what I wanted to do, really what I wanted to do, and maybe taking it outside the smooth jazz box respectfully and do something a little more personal. So I kind of went more in the world chill kind of thing, and as far as instrumentation and vibe.
Yeah, the instrumentation is fantastic. Yeah. So tell us about Rude Boy. I think we're going to, we don't have a lot of time, but I want people to hear something from Pure Lines, because I want them to go out and buy it, because it's so good.
Thank you.
So tell us about Rude Boy.
Yeah, Rude Boy is just a kind of a reggae kind of thing that I wanted to kind of see how it would sound if, like, Bob Marley had, you know, a love child with Miles Davis. So there it is. There's Rude Boy.
Okay, here we go. Okay. We're just going to play like 2 minutes, and then we're going to come back, and you're going to play live right after that.
Great.
It's the best triangle playing I've heard in years.
Thank you, man. I practiced for years.
It's so clean.
I could just picture myself like drinking a glass of wine, having a fire going. This is the album to listen to if one of these cold winter nights.
I was picturing something different.
I know you were.
What was her name?
Accoutrements.
Wasn't important.
So
it's beautiful, man. It's beautiful.
Okay, so Roberto has another tune off his first album, which is excellent too, Boom Boom Boom, that he's going to take us out on his section with, and that's Sabata, right?
Mm-hmm.
Did I pronounce that right?
Sabata.
You have all these exotic names. I don't know where you get them from, but is there any significance to that?
Not really, man.
Yeah.
I just wanted to do something provocative and different and make people think, what is he talking about? I don't know what I'm talking about, but it sounds cool.
Okay, so
that's the most important thing.
Yes.
In this room right now, I am totally excited because we have three of the best musicians in Southern California, maybe the whole United States. Jay Gore on guitar, Keith McKelley on sax, and the great Roberto Vally on bass. And these guys have never seen or heard the tune before, so let's see what happens, right?
Okay.
Whatever happens, happens. Here we go.
G minor.
Thank you.
Woo! I'll tell you what, I did not want that to end.
That was really nice.
Yeah. Oh. If we could take that all the way out, that was
that's cool.
Yeah, man.
So, Roberto, you're playing tonight with Bobby Caldwell, are you not?
Actually, I'm not.
Oh, you're not? Oh, my God. No, sorry about that.
I wish I was. I wish I could clone myself.
I love playing with Dak. I love playing with him.
I know, man.
I mean, you've done it for years. I've only done it a handful of times. But, man, what a great guy.
It's a joy every time I get to play with Bobby. It's been over a quarter century. But actually, I started working with Marc Antoine and David Benoit. They did a record together.
Yeah.
It's called So Nice. It's a beautiful
Brazil. Oh, yeah, you're going to the desert.
Yes.
Michael Polo's event.
Yes, yes.
Shout out to Michael Polo and his great events.
Michael Polo, the little kahuna. Yeah, we're at the Westin Hotel, and it's going to be
beautiful venue.
Yeah.
Love it there. Been there many times. Mm-hmm. Roberto, thank you so much. So,
thank you so
your
much
website
for
our people?
Yes, robertovally.com.
Spell it.
Robertovally.
Not EY.
No E.
No E.
Heaven forbid. No. Yeah. Robertovally.com. Yeah, please come visit and friend me on Facebook and
pick up Birdland and Pure Lines.
Absolutely.
And boom boom boom.
Boom boom boom, baby.
Okay, so speaking of boom boom boom, now we're going on to Keith McKelley. Keith, welcome, buddy.
Hey, how's it going?
Good. And I've had the good fortune of seeing you all over Southern California playing with, I don't know, God knows who, everybody.
A little bit of LA Collective, some Harvey Mason here and there, Larry Denver's been fire. So trying to get around, getting the scene.
And doing the Daryl Williams jams.
Daryl Williams jam, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah. Love your playing, love hearing you play. So for our audience, who is Keith McKelley? Why don't we start out the same way we do with Roberto? Start out your early years and tell us about
Sure. So when I was about 10 years old in fifth grade, the teachers would come by, middle school teachers, and show us different instruments, the horns and all kinds of things. And my mom always listened to jazz a lot, so I would always hear the saxophone. So I just recognized the tone of that instrument. So I pretty much based my decision off of my familiarity with how that instrument sounded. So I was like, I'll try that. And then within a year of playing it, it was funny. It's just like I took my kid thing. Legos was my thing. I'd stay up in my room all day for 8 hours a day, do nothing but Legos. And then I transferred that to saxophone. So I was just in my room all day, 8 hours a day, just with saxophone. And I just stuck with it. And I was like, well.
At what age is this?
If I could just keep playing and do, yeah. Well, 10 is when I started.
Wow.
But it was like.
Where did you grow up?
Canton, Ohio.
Okay.
About an hour south of Cleveland. So, yeah, and then ever since then, I started getting into the scene, local scene, with a lot of older musicians around me that would help me out a lot. And that's the thing. I came from, like, the old school guys that it wasn't about, that was great. You sounded good. It was like, nah, man, you got to work on this. That was cool, but you got to work on this. And so it was a constant that all the time, which is great. I'm very thankful for it. So, around 13, 14,
I've never heard anybody say that. That's coming into the show that people actually mentored them like that and said, this is what you have to work on. Generally, people say, people were supportive and all that, but they just got right up in there and told you what.
See, that's what family's for. They're to support you. Your friends and colleagues, and family is for more than that, but, your friends and colleagues are, if you don't have anybody as you're learning something telling you, no, that's not it. This is what you need to do, and kind of guiding you in the right way. Then they're really not support.
As a young man, how did you take that? Some people might crumble if somebody criticized them.
Well, yeah. Okay. From an early age, I was getting that. So I really developed thick skin really early on.
It's kind of the vetting process that all musicians go through when you're young that kind of is indicative of whether or not you're going to be able to survive in this business.
Right.
It really is.
Did you go through that
as well? Of course.
Yeah.
Of course. I always never wanted to be the best guy on stage. I think if you're the best guy on stage, everybody else is on stage with you, you're going to have to come down to their level.
Mm-hmm.
See what I'm saying? Whereas if you're the weak guy on stage and you truly are talented, you're going to come up to the level of the people you're playing with.
Yeah.
And that's what you always
young
want.
Young person, that's a good
absolutely
thing.
Yeah. Then you get to a level where there is no best or worst. You're all just great players, and everybody's different.
Yep.
Yeah.
Talk about young players. The drummer that's going to play with us today is 15 years old, and I played with him a few weeks ago. His name is Vinny Aguas, and he's a prodigy beyond.
Wow.
He's got the He's got the groove of Jeff Porcaro.
Wow.
And he solos like Vinny. I mean,
wow.
And yeah. But as great as he is, you know, he is so humble, and he mm-hmm. asked me, you know, Roberto, what can I do? And I said, look, your instincts are just incredible. You just keep on doing what you're doing. Use yeah. your ears. If I could just say one thing, being that you're the drummer, you're starting the song, you know. The first set, you gave us two bars for nothing. Then the second set, you just played one bar and you came right in.
Right.
So if you can be a little bit more consistent, my point is he was able to, as brilliant
he's receptive. Mm-hmm.
As yeah, he exactly. is, he's important. Hungry to
and
get
that's
better.
Why he's there.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
Exactly.
So.
You know, I went through that same thing that you mentioned earlier about excited about playing a lot of notes, you know, mm-hmm. that kind of thing. That was one of the things that a lot of the older guys around me would mention. It's like, okay, that was cool, but, you know, in context, what are you doing? What are you saying? Are you telling a story? So from an early age, I pretty much learned from all those butt kickings at the gigs. And I still, you know, I carried that with me, and I take it on myself. So every time I hear myself play, I'm like, nah, you know, it's just constantly trying to chip away at what's better. And, you know, just from an early age, like I said, I started gigging about like 15, and I've been doing it ever since traveling, things like that, and working on projects. I was always kind of a solo artist, even though I was a backup artist as well, and I loved doing both. But, you know, in Ohio, I had my first project out in like 2009. And then a Christmas album, and then after that I've been traveling and stuff, and now I've been working on this latest album that we'll get to later, but it's just been an interesting journey.
I think as a sideman, isn't it really a challenge to try to get your own music out because you're so busy playing?
Yeah, it's balancing the time between having excellence at that level to where you want to get those calls and you want to do those shows, but at the same time allocating enough time to really flesh your own ideas out and present them to the world as well.
Yeah, it's tricky. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and then when you're lucky enough to play with the artist who welcomes you to sell your product right next to theirs.
Oh man!
So that's
right.
That's just incredible.
Yeah, Mindy was always great about that.
Yeah,
yeah,
yeah. Because I mean, the record stores are gone, and the club.
Yeah, that's a big deal because, you know, like without that. Forum to sell CDs, you know, like the gigs are one of the main yeah. forums to sell CDs, and somebody's big enough
yeah.
to let you sell next to them. That's a big deal.
Well, Mindy taught me that, you know, when the gig's over, the work starts.
Mm-hmm.
Seriously. Because, you know, you go out and you do an hour and a half, and with Mindy, it was kicking butt for an hour and a half. It was high energy show, as you know.
Yes,
you've seen Mindy
yeah.
many times. And then you want to go to the dressing room and relax. And Mindy's like, when I put my first record out, Mindy would grab me and go, come on. I'm like, what? Show's over. She's like, no, we got to go do the real work now. And she dragged me out there to meet the fans and sign the CDs.
She's a consummate example.
Absolutely.
Of what you need to do. And, you know, I see so many people make the mistake. You're at a gig, say tonight, you're at Michael Paulo's event. You know, it'd be easy. You come off the stage, fans greet you, and they're excited to talk to you and all that. But if you actually spend time sitting right there,
yeah.
you know, half the people will leave and there's no boom, boom, boom being sold or Pure Lines or
right.
or whatever. Mm-hmm. Will, our co-host here, he said one of the biggest challenges is to make it over to the CD table.
It's right very afterwards. True. Because
yeah.
I thought she was being gracious enough to let me sell my CDs at her shows.
Yeah.
And she said, listen, I'm letting you sell your CDs at my shows, but you need to come out there with me and sit behind that table.
Right.
Because otherwise you're not going to be selling CDs at shows. They're just going to be sitting there at the table.
And right, that shows you the kind of non-ego that she has.
Absolutely.
That she'd be willing to like share the spotlight
and the
change in people's pockets.
She always told me that. She always said, listen, never worry about outperforming. Never worry about taking the spotlight from me. She says, I know it's my show. And the better you look, the better I look. The better everybody on stage looks, the better it makes her look. And that was I thought it was very interesting because there was a, you know, complete lack of male ego from her.
That's true.
Man, we have that. We have that. You know, it's my name on the marquee. Everybody stand 3 feet behind me.
That shows you how confident she was
Absolutely.
With herself. You know?
Absolutely.
Yeah. But again, she just has that innate sense that it is better. You know, right. Jay comes up and jams or whether it's better. Keith, I've been seeing you do that a lot, like with Adam Hawley.
Yeah,
you guys got a great chemistry together.
Very nice chemistry.
Yeah, mm-hmm. You really do. So we're going back to when your youngest days, right? Mm-hmm. So what happened after that? You're like 15, you're gigging. Like, what was your first gig like? What was that like?
Well, my
Do you
first,
even remember?
I don't remember my very, very first gig, but I remember my first gigging experience, my first regular club gig. It was like this place called Chili's on like 12th Street. And we just did, the band was one of these musicians, they just went all over the map. We just do some straight ahead tunes, just some swing stuff. And we do some funk things and a little bit of, not Weather Report, but Headhunters. We would do some things like that. And that's where I kind of learned those tunes. I'm like, oh, I don't know this song. Like, well, listen to it. If you don't get it the second time. And if you didn't get it the second time, they were looking at you like, come on. But and they knew that I probably wouldn't get all of it, but it was still enough to just make me go, oh, my God. And I was
Is that the thing with, like, being a professional musician? You just got to listen to it and be able to play it.
Well, that's part of it. I mean, it's a big part of it. Definitely got to have ears. But, you know, the reading and everything and it's involved with it. In that specific situation, it really helped me get my ears together and learn tunes and really go home and ask the right questions. Like, okay, what song should I learn to be a working musician? So when you go out there, there's going to be a list of certain standards that everybody knows, and you just got to know those things. So that was, like, early on what I was doing. I was just, like, honing my ears, learning tunes, and I'm still learning tunes. I mean, it never ends.
Never ends.
Yeah, exactly. So I'm still kicking myself in the butt. But then after that, you know, I wanted to get my solo thing going in my early 20s, and I started traveling a little bit, and I was fortunate enough to meet Bob James, like, when I was, like, 22, 23, because he has family in Canton. So he'd come in town, and his son-in-law actually plays really good keyboard player. And we were doing gigs, and he was like, hey, man, my father-in-law is coming to town, and want to throw a concert together. So I was like, already crapping my pants, like, oh, my God. So that was, like, my first real big, like, kind of thing where I was just like, man, this is that, yeah, I definitely want to keep doing this forever. And I was fortunate enough to get him as an actual guest on my new CD coming up. So that's been excited about that as well.
Let's talk about that CD. So yeah. What have you been...
Well, every CD is kind of special to me for one reason or other. This specific project is because I started recording and writing it in Ohio. And then I moved to Phoenix for 2 years.
What year was that?
Oh, man. I think I started writing that in 2012.
Okay.
And there's tunes that are probably even older than that I just, you know, and then some are new that I just wrote last year. So it's like songs and musicians from Ohio transferred to Phoenix. I used some musicians there, recorded some songs too, and then I got most of it done. And then LA, it's like now I met all this plethora of great musicians. So it's like this CD is like the beginning to me of like an ongoing thread of just great musicianship that I keep running into. And it's kind of a conglomeration of just like three different areas, three different vibes combined into one. And it's turning out to be something that is really cool, I think.
Do you think it's an eclectic mix of songs, or is there kind of a common theme to it?
It's kind of eclectic with some common themes. Like the styles of the songs vary, but there's always like a little electronic element to it. Some of them are just are way different. So it is kind of eclectic, and then about half of it is like kind of one theme.
Are you drawn to the electronic because of your love of the iwi?
Oh, yeah, actually, I love playing the digital wind instrument. It just opens up a whole world of possibilities for me. Gigs that I probably would have never done, certain pop gigs and R&B gigs that they don't want sax on every song, and they might want some background vocals or some electronic stuff, so that's great to carry around.
First time I ever saw one of those was at the Big Potato here in L.A., a guy named Steve Tavlone. You know Steve?
Steve Tavlone, yeah.
Yeah, he was playing
one. Playing
like, what is that? Yeah, it was like him and... Carlos Vega on drums and Mike Landau and I think maybe David Garfield on keyboards. And whipped one of these things out and I was like, what is that? It was probably mid-80s, maybe late-80s.
Oh, right. The older versions of the when you had to bring the module to the side.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it'll hit like a
For our audience, can you hold it up and they can maybe explain it a little bit to them?
This particular one is made by the company Roland and they call it the Aerophone. So it's
is this the one they just came out with? Or?
Yeah, it came out. This is their second version of it. They came out with it 2 years ago, so it's pretty new on the market.
Yeah, NAMM probably two years ago. Yeah,
that's where they debuted it. Absolutely.
Yeah.
And all the sounds are built in.
Yeah, absolutely.
Versus all the sounds used to have to MIDI it into a rack mount module.
Oh, sure. Yeah. Back in the day,
and use a MIDI cable. Yeah, it was the whole thing.
Yeah,
is there like a LED readout anywhere, like which shows you like what?
Yeah,
what
actually, right in the back here, there's a screen.
Okay.
And it lights up. You can scroll and edit all your sounds. And also, you can edit it through your phone. It's really cool. I can just plug this in and just edit.
Yeah, well, we're going to hear it like now, basically.
Sure.
So, of the two songs, which one is off your current project, the two that you gave me?
In My Room is off my current
project. Okay, so why don't we do that first?
Okay.
Let's give a little intro, and maybe you guys could join in. Is that possible?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. All right, so give us a little intro to In My Room.
Okay, In My Room. Just basically, I started writing. I was having trouble coming up with a name for this. So I wrote the tune, and I got this lick in my head. Ba-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da, and it just kept looping. So I asked my drummer, I was like, man, I can't figure out a name for this song. He's like, where'd you write it? I was like, at home. He's like, call it In My Room.
There you go.
Good. All right.
So for those of you back there, that's why they call it Inside the Music. You heard it first here. That's how we came up with the name In My Room. Okay, so here we go, guys.
Thank you.
Yeah, very Woo. Cool.
Wow, guys. Wow, that's amazing. Really, really good. Can't wait. Thanks. Now, what's your, do you have any timetable for coming out with your CD?
Yeah, June or July. One of those 2 months.
Oh, okay. That's coming on. It's pretty
release.
Soon.
Yeah, yeah.
So how many tunes do you have finished so far?
Finished? I have about 8.
Yeah. Oh, you're almost
so,
there.
Yeah, yeah. In fact, I'm toying with just doing the 8 and reserving the next 3 for the next album.
Yeah.
So it just depends on the timetable. Yeah. If I can get it done in a timely manner, then, you know, I'll get all 11 done.
Well, that's amazing. I can't wait to see and hear that.
I'm pretty excited about it.
Yeah.
It's going to have a nice mix of music on there.
Yeah, that's really, really good. Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank
Can
you.
I ask you a question?
Yeah.
Did Mikey dress you today?
No, he didn't, but he's watching. Actually, I got this from the Dave Cause Cruise.
Oh.
Like when we were in Venice.
You coming this year?
Huh? Yeah, I am, yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah. Jay's kind of a regular on the Dave Cause Cruise.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So tell us what you're doing now, mm-hmm. gig-wise. What's been going on?
Well, tonight, JJ Severino, guitar player.
Oh, okay.
I'll be with him at Spaghettini tonight.
Yeah.
And then the Mediterranean, which is in San Diego.
I'll be there on
Sunday.
Oh,
cool.
Yeah,
very
yeah,
cool.
Yeah, yeah.
And then Sunday morning, I'll be at this nice chicken and waffle place doing a solo gig.
I've seen
Fat
that.
And Juicy.
I've seen that a lot. Have you played there yet?
Yeah, I have, actually. Really, really cool vibe. Really cool vibe. Yeah, come
so
on
that,
down.
Is that a new place? That's in Temecula,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, very new in Temecula. I just kind of, it's a chill vibe. I just kind of set up and do my little solo thing. So I got that going on.
Daryl's playing over there too, right?
Yeah, Daryl, yeah.
Right?
He's yeah. doing Friday nights, full band.
Yeah. And how's the crowd there?
Oh, very cool. I mean, I haven't been there on Friday, but Sunday it's
Where's
really.
Where's that?
It's in Temecula.
Okay.
I don't know exactly the street, but yeah, it's definitely in Temecula. Fat and Juicy. P-H-A-T. So remember that. P-H-A-T.
So have you tried the chicken and waffles?
Oh, yeah. It's really good. Food
yeah.
is great. Yeah. So that and let's see what else I got. That's pretty much it for the weekend. But yeah, I got a lot of cool.
Harville's on Mondays.
Harville's on Mondays. Yeah, yeah. I'm going to come by and check you guys out. That's cool, man.
I do this thing I want to mention real quick. On Monday yeah. nights, and it basically it's a jam session at Harville's in Santa Monica. But we use it as a fundraiser for the Raffia School of Music.
Mm-hmm.
So all of the money we raise there on Monday
you
nights.
You guys have some great musicians turn out.
Incredible.
Yeah.
Like the greatest musicians yeah. in Southern California come through there.
Are you getting to be the MC there or what's going on?
I do it when the regular MC, CeCe Thomas, who's the bass yeah. player for Diana Ross.
Right.
He, if he mm-hmm. has to be out on the road with Diana and I'm still in town, then I take over for him while he's on the road. And all the money goes to the school for kids who can't afford music mm-hmm. lessons and can't afford music school.
Kudos to Harville's for having that there.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. That's really important.
Yeah. Seven and Jason, the guys over there that uh-huh. own it. Yeah, they're.
And a fun hang for you guys, right?
Great hang. Get to stretch out, you know?
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Great yeah. great group of musicians.
Keith man. Comes in and kills it, man.
Keith, have you gone there?
Yeah, yeah. It's yeah. a great band, man. Yeah. I love playing there. It's fun. Fun hang, real loose, you know?
Yeah.
Okay, everybody. So be on the lookout for mm-hmm. Keith McKelley.
Oh, I forgot to mention, I'll be also at Spaghettini again with Adam Holly for a CD release. And that same weekend on March 25th with Eric Valentine for a CD release.
All right, yeah. So
I'd like to drop a couple of places where I'll be playing.
Please
too,
drop
it. Might as well.
Please drop it.
Well, I'm going to be dropping names here.
Drop it like it's hot.
All right, so here we go. So tonight with David Benoit and Marc Antoine, next week at Spaghettini. With with Will Donato and Eric Chocolate Valentine is going to be playing drums, so
oh, cool.
it's going to be a great band. And then the first weekend, Friday night in April, I'll be playing with Brothers Brown, Paul Brown's jazz mm. and an R&B mm. thing at Spaghettini.
And it's a blues, right?
Yeah,
yeah, blues band.
We'll play a couple
of
his
there's
hits.
Two Paul Browns yeah. in that band.
There is.
I hope Paul Brown, number two, is going to come. He's a monster
yeah.
organist.
Yeah. yeah.
There are two of them.
Yeah. Plays the B3.
Yes.
Yeah. There's two Paul Browns. I think Paul Brown here was saying that the other Paul Brown was getting his royalty checks or something. They met at the Grammys or something, I think. And then there's some. Paul has a great story on that.
As if one Paul Brown wasn't enough, there have to be two.
Yeah, there's right. two. yeah. Well, we're looking forward to all those gigs. I'll be at the Mediterranean. I'll see
oh,
you there.
Oh, cool, yeah.
And
can we give a shout-out to Biscuit?
Let's give a shout-out to Biscuit.
Ashling, baby, we
yeah.
love you.
Okay, so to take us out, we're going to do a song, one more song. This is Looking In? Is
yes.
that it? Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And
will
what
be on
was
the new
this
album.
Off of?
This is going to be released with my new project coming up.
Oh, okay.
So this is like an upcoming song that's going to be released.
Okay, all right. So here's a world premiere.
Yes, absolutely.
Of a song in the making. And here we go. And everybody, just to do some business, you can catch us on Facebook Live on my page, Jack Cohen, Jay Gore's page. In case you missed part of the show, you can watch the whole thing. Keith McKelley's page or Roberto Vally's page. And we'll see you again on the 17th of March, where our guest is, you've heard his name mentioned here several times, Eric McChocolate Valentine, who is ripping up the charts. He's just tearing them up.
Yeah.
So
number
congratulations,
one.
Eric.
Number one.
Excited to have him on. Okay, here we go, guys. Well, let's take us out. That sounds like a hit song to me. It really does.
Definitely.
And by the way, we have the lovely Cheryl Aronson here today.
Hey. From
the Hollywood 360. So, Cheryl.
Jack, can you talk about March 10th, Hands for Hope concert?
Cheryl, grab Roberto's mic and go ahead and say, we only have a minute because we're done.
Everybody, March 10th, Hands for Hope. It's a great charity, fabulous concert featuring, well, we're honoring Bill Withers, featuring Mr. Larry Dunn and Greg Adams and Miss Gail Johnson and Jazz and Pink. Everybody come out.
Okay. Cool. So everybody, thanks so much for tuning in. First and third Saturday every month, you can catch us here. And I don't know about you guys, I loved it thoroughly. I mean,
oh, thanks for having
so
me.
Great
fun.
Having all three of you here. Jay, thanks again.
It's over?
It's over.
Oh, man.
Oh, I know. Everybody feels that way. Okay, everybody, be safe and have a great weekend. Catch some of that live music. Go to Spagatini tomorrow night. If you're in Southern California, go to the desert tonight. Go to
Spags tonight.
Yeah, Spagatini tonight, Mediterranean tomorrow
night.
That's right. Mm-hmm. Okay, bye, everybody.
Ciao, ciao.
Later.
It's Inside the Music with saxophonist Will Donato and co-host Jack Cohen. We bring you renowned recording artists and musical guests from around the globe, featuring live in-studio performances from our very special guests. We broadcast live from the LA Talk Radio studios the first and third Saturdays of each month in stunning HD video. Thank you for tuning in to Inside the Music.